Thank you. So welcome everyone to my talk. Thanks for coming to my talk. So before I start, this happens to be my third consecutive Berlin Buzzwords, and the fifth consecutive year I'm coming to Germany. The first time I was here was for Flink Forward back in October 2015. I was on that side of the stage doing the talk. My first Berlin Buzzwords was 2 years ago. I was on this side of the stage. And again, I had one more talk at Flink Forward last year in this side of the stage. I'm back here again. Okay. And the other fun fact is the taxi guys in Berlin know me pretty well because I come here so often. And every time I'm at the airport, they're like, oh, you're back. Yeah, I'm back. Yeah. Okay, without further ado, let's get started. So I'm a member of Apache Foundation, and I work for Amazon Web Services. That's my day job. And I'm a committer on and a PMC member on a few Apache projects. And I do contribute to Beam and Flink in the past. So before, how many of you guys have to deal with satellite image data as part of your job, or you know, are working in the field of agriculture? Oh, sorry. Lars is there. OK. So today we'll be looking at trying to determine the crop health of vegetation crops using a Landsat satellite, Landsat 8 satellite. And how do we do that? We'll be looking at how do we do that, how do we do the feature engineering for actually determining the crop health, trying to identify whether it's a crop or it's a barren land or it's a desert or an ocean from satellite images. So the agenda would be like a brief introduction of what are the techniques that are being used today for analyzing satellite images. And we'll be looking at a brief description of Landsat 8 satellites specifically and what the images are, how the images are. And what is the connection between satellites and vegetation. And we'll be looking at something called NDVI, and how do we do the feature engineering, how do you filter out the images that have cloud cover, or how do you remove the cloud cover from images. And trying to predict the vegetation, you know, how dense the vegetation is. And yeah, we'll be looking at putting it all together in a streaming pipeline, end of it. So a brief introduction. Of late, we have seen that, you know, a lot of things are being done with deep learning, regardless of random forest, even if random forest works fine. So unless you say, oh, I use deep learning, people don't accept your solution anymore, right? So we have to use deep learning for everything, even though random forests work perfectly fine. So the reasons for that being that a lot of the research from academia is finally making it to mainstream industry, and you have plenty of compute power on the cloud providers, Google or Amazon. And it's a combination of both the compute resources and the big data, the amount of data that you have, and the deep learning models and algorithms that you can use for producing useful and interesting applications. Okay, so in this, we'll be looking at using computer vision techniques for analyzing satellite images. And most of the satellite images today are available for free or very low cost, along with some of the ground truth data for those images. And every cloud provider, be it Amazon or Google, we have it on Google Earth Engine or AWS Earth, or even Microsoft has it on Azure. They're available for free or for very low cost. And we are going to train a deep learning model to determine the vegetation health. So the goal here is to identify a vegetation index, okay, from a Landsat 8 satellite image. So this is an example of what a Landsat 8 satellite image looks. And this region, this particular photograph is from the region called Paradise in Southern California that went on fire last year, that caught fire last year and got burned down. So this was before it caught fire, okay, this image. So the data for this, we are getting it from Landsat 8 satellite. It's an Earth observation mission from Earth Observing, I forget what EO stands for, but it's also used by USGS, US Geological Survey. And it's got 10 spectral bands that goes all the way from the visible to the shortwave infra. And each band has a resolution of 30 meters for each pixel, right? And the data is updated on a very daily basis. They update the data every day, so images get uploaded, downloaded several times per day. And it's open data, it's part of open data policy. So the Landsat 8 satellite, it happens to have two sensors. Okay, well, the first one is called Operational Land Imager, or OLI. And the other one is thermal infrared sensor. And both the sensors, the cameras, they have resolutions of 30 meters per pixel, covering the visible to shortwave infra ranges. So these are the look, some of the bands that we have in Landsat. As I said, they have 10 bands. So the band B1, it's got a range in nanometers of 435 to 451, and the resolution is 30 meters for each pixel. And if you're trying to identify the coastal regions, you know, where is the coast and where is the ocean and the land, where do they separate, that's where you look at the B1 band B1 data. And you can also use this band for determining the amount of moisture content in the atmosphere. And it's called aerosol. That's what they call it. And the B2, B3, and B4, they're the RGB, the visible range. And B5 is the near-infrared, okay, NIR. And B6 and B7 are the shortwave infrared. Okay, so what is interesting for us to analyze which of these bands are going to be useful for us to determine crop health? So obviously, we can ignore band one because we are not trying to identify where is the coastline and where is the sea and where is the land, where do they separate. We are not trying to determine the health of coastline or beaches. So we start looking at B2, all the way from B2 to B7. Those are the bands we are interested in. So how is this all related to vegetation and plant life? And what is the connection between the satellite images and vegetation? So you know how plants grow, right? Plants use photosynthesis for growing to generate food and to feed themselves and to be healthy. And so the way they do that is they absorb the solar radiation from the sun, okay? And the wavelength of the radiation is between 400 to 700 nanometers, and it's called photosynthetically active radiation. So that's what they emit, they absorb for photosynthesis. At the same time, they also emit radiation in the near infrared spectrum. So they re-emit some of the radiations back, the plant leaves, the plant tissue leaves, they re-emit the radiations back. Now, that's the reason why some of the plants, they seem to appear bright, because they're emitting near-infrared radiation, they seem to appear bright in the NIR spectrum. So the plant chlorophyll, the chlorophyll and the mesophyll of plants, it absorbs visible light between 0.4 to 0.7 micrometers. And the chlorophyll content, the amount of energy that's absorbed by chlorophyll, it varies between plant species. So a rose versus a jasmine plant, it absorbs different amount of energies. And the energy that is again re-emitted or radiated back is also in different ranges. It differs between plant species. Also, within the same plant species, like a small rose versus a much elder rose, the amount of radiation that's absorbed and emitted differs. So based on how much has been emitted and how much has been absorbed and how much has been emitted, you can kind of determine which species of the plant it is. You can determine how old the plant is or, you know, how healthy the plant is. So these are some of the metrics that you can determine from the satellite images. And the plant leaves, as I said, they reflect the near-infrared radiation from 0.7 to 1.1 micrometer range. And since each leaf is radiating energy back, the more leaves are the greater the canopy, the leaf canopy for a plant, the greater the energy that's radiated back to space. And that's what the satellites capture in the space, right? So the more energy you have, it obviously means that the canopy is very dense. So the differences in the plant reflectances can help determine, you know, how the plants are distributed in a geographical region. And you can analyze that distribution of plants from the satellite images based on the energy that's reflected back. Now, how do we measure, how do we quantify all this? So you're absorbing energy, and then you're reflecting energy back, and how much energy is being reflected back, and how dense is the vegetation? So these are the things that you want to quantify from a satellite image. So how do we put all this together into a mathematical formula? So there is a metric called normalized difference vegetation index. And this has been used, this is extensively used and abused for monitoring agricultural production and for determining the drought regions where there is scarcity of rain, or, you know, the rain, you don't see much rainfall. So there's a high risk of being turned into a desert zone. And most importantly, to trying to predict fire zones where there's a very high likelihood of catching fire. So in case the plant chlorophyll content is less, it obviously means that the plant is not very healthy. So you have less radiation coming out of the plants, right? And so basically this NDVI, the formula is the near infrared, NIR is near infrared, minus red, divided by near infrared plus red. Right? If you look at this, you can it's also possible that it all turns out to be zero. Then what you can do is you can add a small error in the denominator just so they avoid a divide by zero error. And going back to one of the previous slides about the different bands, you see that the band B5 is near infra and band B4 is red, right? So going back to the formula here, you can calculate the NDVI from the bands B5 and B4 for Landsat satellites. And you can also do this using other satellite images from Sentinel-2, for example, European Space Agency, Sentinel-2. I think in Sentinel-2, the near-infrared is band 8, and B4 is red. Okay, and the range of values that NDVI can take is between -1 to +1. Okay. So just the theory part of it, if let's say you have a very dense green canopy, which you have a Amazon forest, and then the NDVI value for the dense vegetation would be typically between 0.3 and 0.8, right? It's in the higher positive side of the spectrum. But something like deep ocean, not the one near the coast, but far away in the deep ocean, we know that water does not reflect much light back, radiations back, right? So you would see this values always being in the negative range, or it may be very small positive, just slightly greater than zero or almost zero. And similarly for soil does not absorb energy, but it reflects a lot of radiations back, near infrared radiation. That's the reason why soil gets really hot. And so they tend to have a very small positive value, which is always less than 0.2. At the most, it can be 0.2. So once you calculate the NDVI index, based on what the NDVI values are, you can kind of, you know, determine whether it's a soil or whether it's a forest or a crop cover or whether it's water. Okay. So this is a slide that shows you the typical red and NIR values. And this is what is 0.1 and what is 0.5. It's called the reflectance. Those are the reflectance values. And so for dense vegetation, then NDVI is typically between 0.7 and 0.8. For dry soil, it's like 0.025. And so you have clouds and snow and ice and water. And clouds is a little tricky because you know, when you have when the images have clouds, depending on the time of the year and the seasons, what the season is, most of the images may just have cloud cover. So you have like 40% cloud cover, it may be completely cloud, fully cloudy. So, and when you have water in the atmosphere, the radiation that's emitted back, it's kind of scattered around, right? So that's a little tricky, trying to deal with the clouds. We'll be looking at how to filter out the clouds in the next slide. So the complete workflow, putting this theory, we have, once we have passed the theory, putting it all together, the complete workflow is you download the images from a satellite, and then once you download the images, you filter out the images that have the cloud cover, and then you look at the remaining images and try to predict whether it's a vegetation and how healthy the vegetation is, or whether it's water or soil or a barren land. Okay? So yeah, and that's the goal here. So the data acquisition, so there are different ways you can get access to the data. So the data is available for free for the most part as open data. One way is you have, in Europe, you have Sentinel web mapping service, which is from a company called Synergize. And you can download the Sentinel-2 satellite as well as Landsat satellite images from a web mapping service. The other option is you can go to AWS Earth, which is, so Amazon, AWS Web Service, in a, they have all the satellite images in S3 buckets, different S3 buckets. It's not only Landsat, even for other satellites like Sentinel and Amazon has a lot of geospatial data sets and for different satellites. So the other option is you can get this data from an S3 bucket, okay, from one of the AWS S3 buckets. Now, if you see this, this is Landsat scenes for pad 044 and row 033. Okay, so what I'm trying to do here is I'm trying to get the images for Paradise, California, Southern California, that went on fire last year when they had the big fires. So the challenge here is trying to determine which path would the satellite have been and which row of this path would you have to look at for Southern California. So it took me a little bit of hacking. Number one, I had to get the latitude, longitude of the place. And then I had to go through one of the Landsat viewer. They have an online browser for browsing the images, and then wherein you specify the latitude, longitude, and then they give you the list of images. So if you look at the image format, it says LC08. LC08 is Landsat 8. And L1 TPS from the thermal image processor, one of the sensors. And 044 is the path, and 033 is the row. And the next part is the date the image was downloaded. So 2019-06-04 is June 4, 2019. And the remaining of that. So that's the format they have for these images. Now, if you look at one of this, and so you can download this data from S3 bucket. And then, so that's AWS S3 command to download the data. So I'm downloading it from Landsat 8, 044, 033. And you can download the data locally to your machine. And so this is what I just showed you. And then the data looks like this. So this is for, again, the Paradise region of California. So that image was from, I think, before it went on fire. And then the next image has some cloud cover on it. And what do you think the last image is? What is that? Is it cloud? Well, it's a smoke from the fires, right? So this is how the data looks. And these images are only from the RGB bands, the visible spectrum, right? So just for the display purposes, visualization purposes. OK, so the next step in the process is you got to filter out for cloud cover, right? So and you got to do this for each of the bands, so B2, B3, B4, B5, B6, and B7. So need to remove the cloud cover from the images before further processing. So there are different approaches for this. Last year, when I was in Berlin Buzzwords, I did a talk about Sentinel-2 satellite images and trying to identify tulip fields in Netherlands from Sentinel-2 images, trying to identify the tulip beds. So the way we did cloud filtering for that was to train a ResNet 50 deep neural network for filtering out the cloudy images and just classifying them as cloudy or not cloudy. So, but here, I took a much simpler approach, because number one, when you run deep learning algorithms, you're throwing carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, because deep learning, they take a lot of power, right? So what you do here is you mask the clouds from all the feature bands. And how do you do that? So basically for an entire year, like for all of 2018, like from January 1st of 2018 to December 31st, you get all the images. And then there's a formula. There's a formula for computing the cloud masking function. So it's like you take the band one, and then it's second power of that, and it's a complete math. And then once you do that, you calculate the median value. You take the median value of that, and overlay that on top of all the different bands in the images. Okay, so that eliminates any cloud factor in the images. So for example, this is only from the bands B2, B3, B4, and so the image on the left, you see a thick cloud cover here, right? You see the cloud cover in between the reds, you see the white path. So once you remove that, once you put the cloud masking function, that's what you get, a clear image on the right. So this brings up to the next step. What is the feature engineering you would do for analyzing this, for going further? So for predicting, and what is the goal here? The goal here is, again, to predict the vegetation index. Going back to the previous slide, yeah. To identify the vegetation index from Landsat images. So what is the feature engineering for that? So use the bands B2 to B7 for training and prediction, and we apply the cloud masking function to each of the bands, okay? And you would do this as part of both training as well as inference time. Okay, so the feature engineering is, the first step is to use the Landsat data surface reflectance data. So when you download this data, let's look at the sample data, how it looks for the images I'm showing here. So now let's say this one is from administrative areas is California, North America, national parks. You have a bunch of national parks in this area, in this image. Now this is data from June 4, 2019, and it has 0% cloud cover. So yeah, it's a clear image. So when I look at this image, it comes in different formats. You have geotiff files, and then you have overlay files. If you have a political map of this region, you can overlay that with a satellite image. And then you have a preview, which is a JPEG preview. Let's look at a large preview, how the data looks. Okay. Now, how do you know about the different radiations and the different band values? For that, it comes with a metadata in a JSON text and a text format. So looking at the JSON, so these are the image attributes. And what was the angle of the sun? What was the sun's angle, angle of sun rays? And what would be the, what was the angle of the reflection? Everything, all of that is captured here. So this is Earth-Sun distance was like 1.01, an astronomical unit. The sun's angle was 128 degrees. And you have a bunch of data here. So the thermal constants, the K1 band and K2 band, and for all the different bands, what are the different values that you have, reflectance values? So yeah, you have all this data that comes with this, which is available for free to download. Okay, so going back here. So you use that data, the surface reflectance data, for computing the cloud mask. And then on the images, you try to classify each pixel on the image as one of whether it's a vegetation, or whether it's water, or a cloud, or snow, or ice, or a barren land, right? And you have to do that just so that you don't you only remove the cloud pixels and you keep the rest of them. That's the idea here. So we just ignore the cloud pixels. We ignore the rest and keep the cloud pixels. I had to fix my slide here. And then you compute the NDVI from the bands B4 and B5. So the feature vector now is you have the seven bands from the previous slide. So these seven bands, and then on this one, you compute the NDVI from bands B4 and B5, add that to the feature vector, and the label could be one of these five classes. Okay. So what are we trying to predict? We are trying to predict whether it's water or whether it's a desert or a barren land or whether it's got some vegetation on it. Okay. So the final step in the workflow, we have filtered out the cloud images from the satellite, we have filtered out the cloud cover from the satellites, from the images, and then now we are ready to determine whether it's vegetation and what is the vegetation index like and how healthy it is, or whether it's just barren land. So for this, we used a deep neural network, a very simple sequential deep neural network with two dense layers, ReLU and softmask activations. And this is the standard stuff, cross entropy, loss function, and we one hot encode the different three labels. Sorry, I didn't have time to create a good diagram, so I just scribbled something last minute. Thanks. So yeah, so we have two dense layers, two hidden layers, and then you have the output. Output is you're trying to predict three classes, one of the three classes, right? That's the reason why we have softmax. So this is the code for that. This is a Keras code. Okay, so I ran this on a few of those images that I downloaded from AWS Earth, the ones that you're seeing here. I ran some of the predictions on this. So this is a Landsat image from October 7, 2018. So you see that there is a big brown patch and there is a small green patch in between. And then the NDVI came out to be like -0.237. Minus means that there is no green cover. Obviously means there's not much green cover. And it's a completely dry land, right? Now going forward, October 23rd. So this one has some cloud cover on it. On October 23rd, there was a cloud factor. So it was, that entire week, they had cloud covers. And this is from November 8, 2018, when they had the big fire. So you can see that there is a smoke cloud. And the NDVI has been pretty much static the entire year. So that's the median value is 0.23 or 0.24. Now this is from just last week, June 4th, or 2 weeks ago. You can see that it's much, after what happened in November, this is how it is in June. So it's kind of got back some of the cover back. There's some green cover back. So so basically from this, the higher the NDVI index, there's a more greater chance that there is a healthy vegetation cover, right? And when you're in negative, it means that there is no vegetation cover at all. And so this can be used to determine, what is the risk of catching of some natural hazard happening. If there is not much chlorophyll in the tissue, plant tissue, and you have not seen much rainfall, obviously it's not green enough, then the NDVI is going to be low, and then you can kind of think that, okay, there's going to be a major disaster going to happen here. So sure, now that you have filtered out the cloud images, and then you have trained a model to classify one of how healthy the crop cover is, how do you scale it all out, right? You want to run it in production. And from my experience working with most of the satellite image companies, they still do it the old-fashioned way, and they run it as a batch. You have all the images sitting in a file system, and then you run a job that runs for many days, and then you have the results coming out. So, but how do you scale this all out? So whether you want to do it as a batch or a stream. So one of my friends from the Apache Mouth community back in, I think it was in November 2011 at ApacheCon in Vancouver. One of his talks, he made a statement, batch is an extension of streaming, except when streaming is an extension of batch. Okay, so what does that mean? Okay, so it's a, then whether do you use Flink or Spark? So a similar quote from a different person. I'll let you read that. Okay, so obviously, most of the deep learning packages that we have are in Python. They're Python-based, and most of the models are stored as NumPy arrays. So it kind of makes sense to scale this out using a Python API and Python framework. So it's either you use PySpark or use something that's more unified batch and streaming. So the obvious solution was to go with Beam. And since we have had a lot of Beam talks today in this Berlin Buzzwords, and we have Beam Summit tomorrow, I'm not going to talk much about what Beam is. But just as FYI, it has different runners like Flink, Spark, and local data runner and data flow. And it has language bindings today for Python, Java, and Go. And it's unified batch and streaming semantics. And it's portable across different execution engines. And it's called unified batch and streaming semantics. And you can extend the model and the API with the different custom syncs and sources. OK, so I'll skip this. This is the Beam's portable architecture. I think there was a session about this morning by Max. So the complete pipeline, the complete workflow in a Beam inference pipeline would look like ingesting satellite data, filtering out for the cloud images, and predicting what the land use is like. And you can run the whole thing in one Beam pipeline. And this is how the pipeline would look like, just a few lines of code. Okay. And so as a conclusion, So if you have looked at seen the images for Paradise, California over 2018, it had a consistent dry vegetation patterns with NDVI throughout the year being less than zero. So it's always been barren and mostly dry. And healthy green vegetation is always in the range of 0.3 to up to 1.0. So with this, you know, if you are living in the area and you see that if you have access to satellite data, you can actually look at this, do some of these computations and determine, okay, if I have property in this area, what is the risk that I'm, what is the risk for this property, in this having a property in this area? You can actually use that to get your insurance coverage for your property based on what the NDVI index is. And how can this be used further? In future work is you can actually use some of this, you can use a shortwave infrared bands to classify rock formations. Rocks emit radiations. It's called radiant flux. And it's the radiant energy that's reflected per unit time. And also the fact that you know plants do not grow on rocks. You can use that fact to determine what the rock formations are. And you can use the images from the red band to identify the borders between countries and regions. And it's pretty much like how you do it with the naked eye. Like this is Germany, well, this is Netherlands. And a few people whom I can credit for some of the work. And here are some links. Earth on AWS. Most of the data is available on AWS for free. It's open data policy. And anybody can download the data from different satellites. They have a bunch of satellites, image data. And it's updated daily on a daily basis. With that, I'll leave the floor open for questions.
OK, thank you for your interesting talk. Now we have time for questions.
Just a quick question on your deep learning model. Have you ever tried to use convolutional neural nets at all? CNNs, convolutional neural nets.
As I mentioned, for the cloud cover, one option is you can use a ResNet to actually identify whether it's a cloud or not a cloud. And I had used that on Sentinel satellite images. But for this, I kind of took an easy, lazy route and an easier route, yes. Right, yeah. So yeah, I could have used a ResNet, and I have used ResNet for cloud cover, for determining cloud cover in the past. And between ResNet, I can use a ResNet 50 or a ResNet 100 architecture. And when we were working with Sentinel-2 satellite images, both the architectures, ResNet 50 and ResNet 100, kind of came up with the almost same accuracy, so we just went with 50. It's a smaller model.
Okay, then we have another one in the back.
Thank you for your talk.
Yeah.
I had two questions, basically. So if I understand it correctly, you first remove the cloud coverage, then you...
So first you remove the pixels with the cloud cover.
Yes.
Okay.
And, so what I'm thinking is, couldn't you get funny results if the cloud coverage basically... If it covers all of the forest area, then you predict drier land than it would be. And
yeah.
The second part to that is you kind of make the assumption that there's no connection between the two things, like forest coverage and clouds. But I don't know much about meteorology, but I think maybe there is actually a connection between like forests attracting, I don't know.
That's a good question. So, well, I did make an assumption that there is no connection between clouds and forest. Okay, yeah, that's a very naive assumption. It may not be true. It could so happen that Amazon rainforests, they have a thick, dense canopy, and they are called rainforests for a reason, because they have a lot of rain. So there's definitely a connection which we need to explore. And the first part of your question was?
That was generally, do you sometimes get funny results that that for a particular area, you usually get one result, but if the cloud coverage is like covering all the dry land, then you, yeah.
So that's the reason why you got to remove the cloud cover from all the different bands, okay? All the cloud pixels from the different B1, B2, all the way up to B7 or B10, all the bands. And then you analyze the what's left for prediction.
Okay, next question. Don't be shy. No questions? Yes, we have one question.
Hello, thanks for your talk. I have a question. How often the data is updated?
Well, it happens for Landsat, it's several times a day. It happens several times a day. And for something like Sentinel-2, which is up here, it's once every 5 days. So that's when the satellite is in position to download the data. For Landsat, it happens several times a day. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Next question. Well, that's not the case, so let's thank the speaker again. Thank you, Suneel.
Thank you.